So let's proceed with the next technical session. And yeah. Well, yeah, a small round of applause would never go in vain. So keep doing that to encourage our team. Now proceeding with the next technical session, I would like to call upon the technology and business all-rounder from Node Express team. Well, she is very cheerful, and the important thing is that she likes Harry Potter, aka Daniel Radcliffe. But she still chooses to be with the Slytherins.
So for I call upon. I don't like Daniel Radcliffe or Harry Potter. I like the universe.
Please welcome Ms. Neha Nivedita, and she'll be introducing you to the world of MongoDB. Please give her a big round of applause.
Hello, guys and girls and everyone else. How are you guys? How are you today? So great to see all of your happy faces. I suppose that everyone is happy, you know, waking up so early on a Sunday morning and coming over here, right? We all are very happy, right? Sorry?
It depends how it goes.
Depends how it goes, right?
Well, we'll make sure we'll keep you encouraging, you know, keep you motivated.
Well, we have a, you know, a huge plan here to make it worth your while and our while as well, you know, because that is what this meetup is all about. So, I hope you guys like this and let's proceed. So today I'll be talking about MongoDB. First of all, I would like to know how many of us here have worked with databases? All of us. Very good, very good. How many of us have worked with SQL databases? Quite a few of us. NoSQL? Few of us. Okay, then this session might be very interesting for you. To begin with, first let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name is Neha, and I am a full stack developer. I work with Node, Meteor, React, Angular, all of these related JavaScript technologies. Apart from this, I also do a little bit of business dealings, in the sense that I work to expand the business concerns of our organization. And what is that organization? It's nothing but Node Experts. I'm proud to be a part of this organization, and it's really cool. You know, like I said, few minutes back, awesome sauce. That's us. Apart from this, when I'm not coding or working towards business goals, I'm also doing a lot of dragon slaying. Can you see the dragon? It's right there, and that's me. How many of us here are gamers? Only 3, 4, 5, 6. It's kind of like chalta hai. Okay. Do any of you know which game this is?
It's Warcraft.
Sorry?
Warcraft?
No. Never mind. That's Dragon Age. Let's proceed. I hope that this will be really enjoyable for you. You know, Vault-Tec thumbs up and all. These are the points that we will be discussing today. First, we will discuss what MongoDB is. Then, we will compare it to SQL and NoSQL. Document data model, which is how MongoDB stores data inside its database. CRUD operations, how we will do data manipulation using MongoDB. Cursor concepts. Cursor is a really cool thing which will be really beneficial for you when you guys start working on Meteor. So we'll discuss a little bit about that as well. Benefits and drawbacks of MongoDB. Use cases and don't use cases. Trust me, there are a few of those as well. So, MongoDB. MongoDB is an open source, document-oriented, NoSQL database. There are three keywords here. First, it is open source, which means that it is developed independently for, by multiple of coders around the world, and it is open source, it's free. Second, it is document-oriented. We will learn more about that in a bit. Third, it uses NoSQL, which means that it does not use traditional SQL queries. But for that, we might have a question. What is NoSQL? Does anyone know? Okay, that's right. NoSQL originated as, alternative mechanisms for data storage and manipulation when we were facing problems with traditional SQL storage engines. It addresses challenges faced by these databases and tries to provide a faster input-output, read-write, and, you know, basically whatever a real-time application in today's date might need. So, coming on to the architecture of MongoDB. MongoDB is set up with some concepts that might be relatable to, SQL, old SQL databases. So, we will try to connect all of those as we go along. First, we come to document. This right here is what a MongoDB document looks like. It is the basic unit of data in MongoDB. What do we mean by basic unit of data? It means that when you go down to the, you know, lowest level, this is whatever data you store, it will look like. It is analogous to row in the relational database. What does the term analogous mean? It means that we can relate it to that. It's comparable to that. So, for as many of us here are familiar with SQL, when I say a document, what I mean is a row in those terms. I hope that makes sense. When we fetch some document from the MongoDB database, we can obtain this as a JSON object, which makes it very easy to work with, you know, in the application layer. But on the disk, it is stored as BSON. Have any of us heard about BSON before? You're right. That is binary JSON. BSON is, its name originated as, you know, comparable to JSON. It basically means binary JSON. It was invented to, you know, create a more space efficient and time efficient scanning of data. BSON is the data format that MongoDB uses to store its data on disk. But whenever we read from it, we will get it in this format, which is, you know, human readable. That is JSON format. So MongoDB does this conversion for us. It is really good. Coming to a collection. So, suppose I have lots of documents. We have a lot of rows. They are going to be stored somewhere, right? Typically in a SQL database, where do we store it? Table. So, this is the table in the MongoDB database. A collection is a group of documents. It is analogous to table compared to SQL, as we just discussed. The most important thing here, however, is that it does not enforce a schema. As we know about SQL, SQL always enforces a schema to go along with its table. It will ask you to define the schema first, and then it will let you insert the documents. And you cannot insert anything that does not match the schema. But MongoDB is not like this. If you want, you can choose to go without a schema and just start inserting data in your collection. It will let you do that. And even if you do enforce a schema, it allows you to very easily update it or change it. That is why we say that MongoDB provides a very dynamic form of schema support. Now, the question might come that if, you know, MongoDB does not enforce a schema, then what is the purpose of having a collection? Just store it anywhere? But we don't do that. You know, from an application perspective, it is better to keep similar sort of data in the same place. So, what we say is that documents in a collection, they have a similar purpose, even though their schemas, their data format might not be exactly same, or they may be same. It's up to you how you choose to use MongoDB. Is that clear to everybody, this concept? Okay, great. Now the database. So, you know, like we put all those documents in a collection, we take a group of collections which are related and put them in a database. The database is basically a container for our collection. It will store all our files on disk. And typically, when you deploy a MongoDB server on your machine, you can store, you know, more than one database on it, you know, which is typical of most databases. Okay, coming on to SQL versus NoSQL. SQL meaning relational, NoSQL meaning MongoDB, non-relational, you know, that's what it is. What are the differences that we have to, you know, watch out for when we are working with this new kind of technology, NoSQL? First, as we already discussed, SQL is table-based. NoSQL is document-based. It can also be key-value pair-based. If we, you know, remember the document that we saw in the first slide, it was stored as what? Key-value pair. Am I right?
Yes.
Right. Okay. So SQL give you a predefined schema, but NoSQL may not have a schema or have a dynamic schema. One of the very important things about using NoSQL is that it is very scalable. How does it happen? If we go by traditional SQL databases, these machines, these database instances, they are usually vertically scalable. Again, the question might come, what is scalability? Scalability is how you increase the processing and storage capacity of your system. Right? Supposing we have a very large application which has a lot of data and we are running out of space on our database server, what will we do then in a SQL database? We will add more space to it. How will we add more space to it? We will need to increase the capacity of the system. This is what is vertically stable, vertically scalable. I'm sorry about that. Which means that if my system had this much memory right now and I need to increase its capacity, I'll need to add more to it. Add more space in the same system. But MongoDB works differently. Okay. MongoDB works differently. What MongoDB lets you do is that you can scale it horizontally. You can add more storage space, memory space, CPU power, whatever it is, to your server instance, but it need not be vertical. You can just add another machine to it, to the whole system. You can keep on adding smaller and smaller, more and more machines, and scale out your system horizontally instead of building a big, powerful system to take the load of your application. This is where NoSQL really shines, because as we might know, how many of you guys, go to Nehru Place for, shopping for your gadgets and all? Quite a few of you, right? Tell me the price difference between, 1 terabyte hard drive and a 8 terabyte hard drive. Does 8 terabyte even exist, in the normal market? What is the price difference? That's right. So we might see that, bringing a single machine with greater capacity, it's much more expensive. But we can buy several machines with smaller capacity and join them together. This is where, the real benefit of NoSQL is. It's cheaper to scale. Okay, so coming on to more architectural differences, SQL is better for relational data. I'm sure that, many of you are already familiar with this term. What is relational data? It's where, your data is connected to one another in several ways. There are joins and all of that. NoSQL is better for hierarchical data. How do we understand hierarchy? One question here. Yes, that is correct. So that is very correct. By hierarchy, we can understand that it supports nested architecture, which SQL doesn't have. However, it is not that great at relational data, NoSQL. SQL is much better for transaction. This is a very important point when it comes to determining whether MongoDB is right for you or not, when you're choosing this for your application. SQL has transactions, but NoSQL does not have it. However, it is better for faster I/O, which is the requirement for most real-time applications these days. Examples of SQL databases, MySQL, Oracle, MSSQL, I'm sure all of you guys know that. But for NoSQL, we have MongoDB, CouchDB, RethinkDB, and all of those. These are, some of the things that relational database is good at and not good at. Relational database is a very good query language. You can just say what you want in, almost English-like language, and it will return you the results. It has strong consistency. You can be sure that whatever data you are inserting in it, it will be correct, right? As long as you are doing your thing correctly. apart from that, it also has the support of secondary indexes. However, it is not good at some things, which is where NoSQL shines. NoSQL is very flexible. Your data structure is changing, doesn't matter. You just, do it in a very dynamic way. You change your data structure when you need it. This really helps in application development process. As we discussed scalability also, it's much faster and much easier, much cheaper to scale. And performance, much faster read writes. That is there. SQL has usually, slower read write times. Document data model. Document, again, was the basic unit of data in our MongoDB. So now we'll discuss how it actually looks like in the database. First, I will start with a very simple example. As I mentioned earlier, I'm really into games, so I've, you know, all my examples are related to games somehow. Here in my relational database, I have a hero table. This hero is the protagonist of a couple of games. Okay, this is a very simple table, two columns. Here we have the name and the game of which that person is a hero. Now I have another table where I have listed the skills of each hero. For example, and to show the joins, I've used color coding. As you can see, the violet is joined this way and the orange one is joined this way. Okay. Each of these hero possesses some skill of which the details are mentioned here. And we are using relations to connect them. Now, if I were to translate this to MongoDB, what will my data structure look like? As we had already discussed, joins are not supported by default. So how are we going to do it? Correct. So when we convert this to MongoDB, we will just embed the document. We will have a single hero collection, and we will take these skills, and we embed them within the hero. Do we see the connections here? I think Commander Shepard uses sniper rifles and tactical cloak. I think those are mentioned here. Right? So what this does, what is the benefit of this? When you have to read some, you know, read this data from the database and your server has to fetch it, it just needs to do one quick query and you get all of your data in a second, less than that. You know? Another good thing to understand about MongoDB is that even though it's just a key value pair, it also understands data types. If this was a document that I had stored in my MongoDB, MongoDB would understand what each of these data types are. It will know that okay, it will know that this is a string, this here is a nested document, this is an array, and this is an integer. So these things are useful when you're designing the schema of your MongoDB database. As I mentioned earlier, you can choose to have a schema if it makes sense for your application. It's usually a good choice. Can everybody see the screen? I'm not certain. Is it visible? Sure? Okay. Okay. Now coming on to the interesting part. See, the purpose of this presentation is not to, you know, give you all the theory about MongoDB in one day. What I want you guys to have today is to have a basic functional understanding of how MongoDB queries work. So that when we go to the Meteor part, things make sense for you. So I'll be giving a very brief outline of how the CRUD operations, data manipulation, you know, certain cursor things, they work in MongoDB. Insert. This is the most basic requirement of any database. We want to put our data in there somehow. Then we are going to use it, right? So suppose I wanted to make a list of the games that I play, right? What will I do? This is the syntax of how a typical MongoDB query looks. This games, this here, what is it? Collection, which is analogous to table, right? And insert is the operation that I'm going to do. Now, I'm just going to pass a JavaScript object in it with the information of the games that I want to store here. I will write the name of the game. I'll write what year it was released and which company published it. This is all I need to store, so then I'll close the object and run this command. That is all I need to do to store the data. As you can see, this syntax is very similar to what we typically do in any JavaScript application, right? So to perform operations in MongoDB, you don't need to learn a new language as such. You just need to know a few commands and everything else is right there. You don't need to understand the query language that is required in SQL. This is the collection. These are the fields and values that are going to be stored. Right? Make sense? Okay, great. Moving on. Fine. Now I have inserted the data and now I want to read it. I want to see what games I play. What will I do? I'll write DB collection name dot find operation. I wanted to find all the games that were released in the year 2007. So again, I will just insert a key value pair as a query. I will write the field that I want to search on, which is year, and then I will write the value I want to search it against, which is 2007. What is this now? Does anybody know what this is? Supposing my data had a whole lot of key value pairs, it was a huge document, there were several values in it, but I only wanted to know the name and publisher of the game.
Only doctor. You are searching only doctor.
Yes, right. So this is the way in which I will select which field I want to fetch from there. I will say, give me the name and give me the publisher. One means that. One means that it's true. Send me the name and the publisher of any document that matches this query. Then I will run this. We have mentioned the collection, the query criteria, and this is a very important concept in MongoDB. It's called projection. Which fields you want to project, right? So when I run this query, I will get the result. I had inserted only one game so far, even though I play loads. It will send me the name of the game that I play and the publisher. Remember, it did not return me the year. I had inserted the year over there, but it did not return me that because I specified which fields I wanted. If I had left this thing blank, it would have returned all the fields that, you know, that are there. Update. Now I have inserted and updated, searched for my data. Now I want to update it. For that, I will just run the update command. I want to update all the games that were released in 2007. And I want to change the publishing company to Electronic Arts, EA. So for that, I will use the set modifier. The first one is the query that I'm running to find all those documents. The second object is what change I want to do. Okay. The third object is additional options that I'm passing. When I say multi true, it means that find all the documents that match this criteria and update them. If this is false, if multi is set to false, it will update just one document and return. And that one document will be the first document that it finds. There are several other options as well, which you can explore further on if you go to MongoDB documentation. But I'm just giving you a brief overview of all the things that you can do. So when I run this query, I have mentioned the collection, the update criteria, the action that I want to do, any additional options. So what it will do is that it will take the document that I inserted earlier on and it will change the publisher from BioWare to EA. Okay. This is how updates work. Now remove. Remove is pretty simple. Again, I just want to delete some data. Supposing I hate EA and I don't like any of its games. So then I'll just ask my database, look, go in there and remove all the games that belong to EA. That is exactly what I'm saying here. I'm asking the DB to remove with the key value pair, publisher EA. You know, that is all I need to do to remove all the games that were in there.
If I have to add a criteria, remove all games, publisher EA, and year 2017 or something.
Right. You will just put a comma in here and then define that additionally.
Define that
additionally here. Just put a comma and put another key value pair.
No keyword here.
Sorry?
You don't have to use any keyword.
This is the keyword that you're sending in. Like, supposing you wanted to find all EA games that were released in 2007. Right? And you want to delete them. Then you will write publisher EA, comma, year 2007 and then pass that. By default, it will be an AND operation. It will check for the... For OR, there is a particular syntax. You can check it out on the official MongoDB documentation. Typically, it will have an OR operator, and then $OR operator, and then you will have, to define the criteria that you want to mention. So then it will check for either one of those. Cursor. Yes.
Is there any way to do the upsert or merge operation like the SQL support option?
Yes, there is an upsert option for that as well. When you're doing insert, you can insert, you can provide an additional options like I showed in the update option, right? We mentioned a multi-true option. If we just go back here, this multi-true. Similarly, you can provide an additional option when you're doing an insert, and you can just write upsert true.
Okay, so it will insert the data.
Right. If that thing is not there, it will insert it, and if it is already there, it will update it. Okay. There are lots of options that MongoDB provides. I'm just giving you a basic overview of the operation that you might need to do, and you can just simply go and, you know, check out the documentation and tutorials to learn more. Cursor is something that was new to me when I started working on MongoDB. I did not really understand what cursor meant. But it is a very important concept when you come to work with Node.js, MongoDB, and especially with Meteor. This is very important in some of the concepts that you will learn later on today in the day. So I'll try to give you a basic understanding of cursors as well. Cursor is the pointer to a result set of a query. Now, if I ran a query on MongoDB to find all of the games that were released in 2007, and supposing there were hundreds of those, so what will it give me back? It will not give me just one document. It will give me a set of 100 documents. Now, cursor is a pointer to that result set. What it enables me to do is to iterate over each of the documents within that set and use them whichever way that I might want to use them. This is important when we want to work with this on an application layer. Clients can iterate through a cursor to retrieve results and work with them. The find queries we saw before, they actually return a cursor by default. Okay. So when we run this query here, this is actually a cursor that we will be getting back. Now there are some ways to navigate this cursor and use that. First, to give you an understanding of how it works. This is the set of documents, all of the games that were released in 2007. The cursor will point to each of the document in the result. And when we run this operation, cursor.next, it will go to the next document. Right? Now, in Meteor, you typically do not have to worry about all of this. It has already been taken care of. But a cursor is important in the sense when you are working with real-time data. Now, this data set that we had got, supposing we wanted it to be reactive. Reactivity is something that we'll learn later on. Supposing if any time somebody inserted a record into the data set, I want it to be available to me instantly. What a cursor will enable us to do is to open a direct connection between the database and the front end. We will learn about this later on, but just giving a heads up where this will come in important. For now, let us discuss some of the cursor operations. These are similar to operations that already exist in SQL. For example, count. When I want to count the number of results that I'm getting from a query that I've run, I want to find all of the games released in 2007, want to find a count for that. Then simply I will append this function to my query, to my cursor. With this, I will get the count of the games that were released. Supposing there were 5 games in my database, then it will return 5. Similarly, there is sort. What does sort do? It will sort the result set in whatever direction that I choose to, depending on the criteria that I pass to it. Example, I want to find all of the games that I have. I want to fetch all of the games that I have and sort it on the basis of year in descending order. So this is how I will write the query in MongoDB. I will run a find on all of the games that I have. Then I will specify this criteria. Here is -1. -1 stands for descending. 1 stands for ascending. Okay. So when I run this query, I will get, the result set with descending order. So for example, 2010 will come first, then 2009, 8, 7, that way. Limit. Limit is used to limit the number of results that we get back from the MongoDB query. It also works in the same way. We will run the find, we'll give a criteria, and then we will limit it to the number that we want. We want only 5 results, then we'll specify that here. Skip. skip is analogous to offset, what we have in the SQL database. Supposing I am running a query, but I don't want a particular number of the first sets, particular number of first documents that I want, that are there. If I have 15 documents, I want to return only the last 10, then I will use skip. I will tell it to skip the first 5 documents. And this is how I'll do that. Okay. Is this clear to everybody? Okay, great. Some observations and, you know, eventual conclusion of today's session. As we had mentioned before, transactions are not really supported in MongoDB. So this is one thing that, you know, we will need to keep in mind when we're deciding the tech stack of our application. MongoDB supports atomicity within a single document. What does this mean? For example, if I run an operation on a document using MongoDB query and it fails, suppose there were several things to be updated within the document, three keys to be updated, but it failed somewhere along the second key. In that case, MongoDB will realize it made a mistake and it will, you know, it will not affect the changes. It will not affect any of the changes. But it does not, provide the operation, system of transactions. If you are performing several MongoDB operations, different operations in a sequence, and you want to roll them back, there is no way that you can do that. If, you know, an intermediary app, query fails, you can't do that in MongoDB. You can do that, you know, using, application level code, but MongoDB does not provide it by default. You can do that in your Node application, PHP application, whatever you're using. So if your application at all requires transactions, and if you don't want any inconsistencies in there, you want the option of rollbacks, then it is suggested that for that part of your application, use relational database. But if you want, you know, fast query access, you want real-time data, for example, think of, you know, a social network where just, you know, start posting updates and you need it to be real-time everywhere and very fast. It's very, you know, small and simple. So for that, things like that, you can use MongoDB. Benefits of MongoDB. It has a schema-less design, as we discussed earlier. You can choose not to have a schema. So this is very beneficial, especially in the development process. And also, you know, if your data has, slight differences in structure that you don't want to manage separately. It is cost-effective. It's totally free. You don't need to pay a dime for it, right? And apart from that, if you want to use some helper libraries on it, all of those are also free using the NPM package that Sapna mentioned earlier, right? It's quick start and fast learning. As we already discussed in these, you know, simple queries that we saw before, if you're familiar with JavaScript, it will be very simple for you to grasp the understanding of MongoDB query language. It provides several advanced features like replica sets and auto sharding. These are, you know, some concepts that we will discuss in detail later on, maybe in a future meetup. But these provide some really beneficial features to your MongoDB based application. You can choose to have master-slave type of architecture setup. You can choose to, you know, partition your data in certain way, you know, for faster scalability and all those things. So, you know, those are what these concepts refer to. It has a strong community of developers, users, contributors. So, you know, if you're running into any problems with that, go on, log on to Stack Overflow or the, you know, MongoDB forums. It's, you know, good support over there. And the technology itself, it's rapidly evolving. So whatever drawbacks they have been facing, they have been working to evolve that, fix that, improve that on a very rapid basis. So it's really good. However, there are some drawbacks as well. There are no automatic joins, right? If you want to do joins, you will have to do it on the application level. Either you can choose to embed your document directly, as we saw in the first example that we mentioned here, or if you still want to keep your data separate in two different collections, then you will have to use a reference key and reference, collate them together in the application layer. Do two different queries and connect them. No transactions. Chances of data inconsistency are slightly higher depending on the configurations that you've set. data size in MongoDB is also typically slightly higher than SQL databases. So these are some drawbacks of MongoDB, which you might need to keep in mind when you're choosing this. Now let's discuss some use cases. When do we want to use MongoDB and when do we don't want to use it? First, starting with when we want to use it. If it's a real-time application and you need very fast input-output, you are storing data with little to no structure and you need fast scaling, then definitely go for MongoDB. It will enable you in rapid development. When not to use MongoDB? These are the don't use cases that we discuss earlier. If your data has a lot of relations, MongoDB is not going to perform very well with that, right? So you need to think about the kind of data structure that your application requires. Asset compliancy and transaction rollbacks, if all of these things are needed, then don't go for MongoDB. If your data structure, if your data is structured and unchanging, you're sure that you're never going to change it, then also you might have to do a rethink whether you want to use this or not. So these are some of the things that we have discussed today about MongoDB. One of the personal things that I want to tell you guys about what my experience with MongoDB has been is that since I started working here directly on Node.js, Meteor, etc., AngularJS, React with MongoDB, I really enjoyed that all I had to do was to learn one language, JavaScript, and automatically I could work on front-end, back-end, framework, database. So as Buzz is very excited here, he's telling Woody, JavaScript everywhere.
Woody seems terrified.
Woody is terrified. I think he's a, SQL master or something, I don't know. He's a bit old-fashioned.
Well, exceptions are always there who are not,
So, yeah. So, I really enjoy using this single language and, watching how powerful it has become, that we are able to harness it, its power in all aspects of application development. So, these are some of my views about it. I feel really strongly about them. So, I thought I should share that with you. So, that's all from me today. I hope, it was a good, enjoyable session. And if you guys have any question, shoot.
Yes, I think it was a very wonderful presentation, quite long enough. But yes, it was. I mean, everyone was lost in the JavaScript world, I can see. So any questions, if anyone has? Okay, we'll be just taking two questions. Yeah. Please speak your name before asking a question.
My name is Abhishek Khawade. My concern is, what were the security concerns in this? How we are managing the security, in MySQL or in general SQLs, we have users specifics and we are managing that things. How we are managing in this?
See, on the database level, you do have some security options. For example, you can define who the users on a system level, the users of a particular MongoDB database can be. But apart from that, if you want to implement a database security, you will have to go there, do that in the application layer. You can, have a server-based system access. Like you can create users on your system who can access a particular database hosted on it. When I say system, I mean a machine, right? You can, put user-based access on that. But if you want to specify the access to a particular set of collections, keys, all of that, you will have to do that on the application layer. You can also specify those things.
I think it requires a detailed answer, I suppose. So we can take it in the end.
Okay.
In the networking break.